Hi, I'm Dr. Nitin Sobal, and I'm going to talk on NT-Scan, IT, and much beyond. So, basically, the 11 to 14-week scan, which is now done almost routinely, has a lot of benefits. We can date and establish chronicity, amnesity if this has not already been done. Most importantly, we can look out for chromosomal abnormalities, screen for congenital anomalies. We used to say major, but now we are looking at more and more anomalies, and of course we can screen for preeclampsia. So as we can see, there are a lot of uses of 11 to 14-week scan. Putting up chorionicity in your report is very important because it makes a lot of difference in management. So that's a typically multichorionic pregnancy with which is here, of course, it's a trichorionic pregnancy. Here it's a dichorionic pregnancy, and you can see the lambda spine. As opposed to that, here we have a monochorionic pregnancy with a very thin membrane separating between the two, and we know that the management of both these are entirely different. We establish the gestational age typically by looking at the CRL, and we all know how to do it by measuring from the crown to the rump in its maximum dimension in a straight line. Then, of course, why this is important is because even at this stage, we can have chromosomal abnormalities like triploidies or, for that matter, trisomy 18 presenting as growth retardation, or when there's a twin, difference in CRL can mean a lot of complications, especially in monochorionic twins. We look at a heart rate. Typically, what we do in our center is when we look at a tricuspid valve, which we'll see later on, at the same time, we measure the heart rate. Again, heart rate can be abnormal in certain trisomies. We look at a placenta. Most of the time, the placenta will be covering the os. We can maybe just mention that. Looking at cervix, measuring cervix is controversial, but some people want it in their report. So we at least report whether the cervix is or cervix is closed. Look at a fetal well-being, a jumping fetus, which is a nuisance to you in the way that you are not able to take your measurements, is good because it's a healthy fetus, just like children running around the house. Whereas if you have a fetus which is just standing quiet, they're not moving at all, that means something is going wrong, just like children who are quiet and not active. So the whole idea of looking out for chromosomal abnormalities is to pick up that odd one. And this odd one in the crowd is not going to stand up easily and say, "Oh, I am that odd one." So we need to take special efforts to pick that odd one. And now we know that over a period of time, by looking at maternal age, certain biochemical markers, and of course, ultrasound features like the NT, nasal bone, DV, and tricuspid valve regurgitation, we can pick up a feti with chromosomal abnormalities from the crowd. So, a nuchal translucency, as we know, is a collection of fluid under the skin behind the neck in the first trimester. This, of course, was popularized by Nicolaides. Earlier, Beryl Benacerraf talked about nuchal thickness in the second trimester, but in the first trimester, we talk of nuchal translucency. So, how do you do that? Hope that the fetus gives you good position, because sometimes the position is not good. You just have to wait and watch. And once you get the fetus in right position, then you gradually zoom that particular area till you get a good nuchal translucent section, where you should see the head and only the part of the upper mediastinum. So technique is very important. Timing typically between a CRL of 45 to 84. Then of course it should be in a mid-sagittal plane. That means you should not see the maxilla. Picture should be adequately zoomed up, of course, very important. And we should make sure that we are not looking measuring the amnion. So if the amnion is close to the fetus, make sure that the fetus jumps. And of course, the fetus has to be in a neutral position, neither too flexed nor too extended. Adequate magnification is very important, and we are going to measure only the black space, putting the calipers on the line between the two lines, and that's a nuchal lucency. What is very important is, after you have done the measurement, we need to correlate it with the CRL, and we can do it by using certain online applications, or we can go to the FMF site and do that. So, how does NT help us? It can pick up almost about 80% of feti with trisomy 21 and others. Chromosomal abnormalities. Here, for example, we have an abdominal NT, we have done a CVS, and we have done a karyotyping. Nowadays, we can also do a microarray because the cost of microarray is quite reasonable. We can not only pick up trisomy 21, we can pick up other trisomies, triploidies and even monosomies when you have an abnormal NT. So then of course the next marker is the nasal bone. Now remember that whenever you want to see anything good on B mode, like for example nasal bone, you have to hit that at almost like 90 degrees. So if you hit the nasal bone with a good ultrasound beam at 90 degrees, you will see it well, and you see two lines there, and of course that's the tip of the nose, that's the skin, and this bright line below that is the actual nasal bone. And in the first trimester, we typically are looking out for presence of nasal bone. We need not measure it in the first trimester, unlike the second trimester. And of course, we look at a tricuspid valve. Again, the picture has to be adequately zoomed. You increase your sample size that you cover so that you cover the tricuspid valve well. And that's a normal tricuspid valve with the E wave and the A wave. And normally, you might see a little regurg, but it should not be more. Typically, tricuspid regurgitation again is associated not only with chromosomal abnormalities, but also with cardiac defects, as we'll see some examples later on. And of course, then we look at a ductus venosus. So you can go to the FMF website and look in detail how to look at ductus, but you can do it in both the planes, the sagittal plane as well as the transverse plane. So here's are three examples of a sagittal plane. And usually it's very easy to identify because that's the area where the umbilical vein suddenly becomes narrow. It sort of becomes a small triangle. And the most important thing is at that point, you see aliasing because of high velocities. So that's the transverse plane again with an NT scan. That's the umbilical vein and that's the ductus there. And again, you can see here in a transverse plane, that's the heart there, of course. And you can see aliasing or lighter shades of color there, telling us that that's the point to sample it. And make sure that your sweep speed is high because you want to spread out the wave, because you want to differentiate between the S wave, the D wave and the A wave. So it is not enough to look at DV subjectively. Now we also do the PI. And the reason why we do a PI is because if you do complete the course in FMF, of ductus venosus, the nasal bone, etc., you can go to the site and enter your PI values of ductus venosus along with NT. And this is what all of you should be doing now. And then you get a risk, a calculated risk with DV, which in, for example, in this case is normal, one in one. From the background risk, in fact, the adjusted risk is much better. This is an artifact, this is not a reversal, the A wave is here. Whereas here we see a reversal of A wave and we see the PI is high and typically the adjusted risk has become high. In fact, people say that if you do this well, this is probably as good as doing or adding biochemical markers. So I would urge all of you to complete the FMF course, get a certification if you have not, and not only a basic certification, but including all the markers of trisomies, right? Very important. So typically when you see multiple things like an abnormal NT with a pulsatile DV or an abnormal NT with a tricuspid regurgitation and a pulsatile DV and or an absent nasal bone, then you have hit your target. And the chances that you will see something wrong either on karyotyping or on microarray are very, very high. And that's what you should be doing. Now, typically the scene is that you have an abnormal NT, the karyotype or the microarray is normal. What do we do that after that? So it's very important to follow up this fetus later on and do an early anomaly scan, maybe 14, 16 week. Look out for cardiac anomalies. Look out for skeletal dysplasia, diaphragmatic hernias, etc. If the nuchal fold persists, maybe rule out infection. If everything is fine and the nuchal fold thickness or NT disappears, that's good enough. If it persists, then of course, look out for other syndromes and inform the parents that there is a 10% risk of evolution to hydropsy and perinatal death. But if it disappears and all your tests are normal, the outcome is going to be quite normal and the baby will be as good as anyone else in the general population. This is a very important thing for counseling. Okay, so what we do again is we not only look at the ultrasound features, but also combine the biochemical markers, that is the double marker, 3-beta-HCG and PAPE, and then you can get an adjusted risk. For example, here we are looking at ultrasound, picking up the biochemical markers, we have an adjusted risk which is very low, and here we have an adjusted risk which is very high of 1 in 165. So after you have calculated the effective risk or the adjusted risk, what we need to do is look at the value. So typically the risk is very high, say 1 in 50 or 1 in 100, you need to do an invasive test. If the risk is very low, say above 1 in 1000, Then, of course, you should just repeat a routine target scan maybe at 18 weeks of gestation. But if the risk is intermediate, that is between 1 in 100 or say up to 1,000, then you have now an option of doing an NIPT. So that's a good a subset of patients where we have an intermediate risk, where you are not sure whether you should do an invasive test. At the same time, you don't want to take any chances. This is a group where you can subject them to NIPT. Now, we expect to do a lot of structural, we expect to see a lot of structures in the first trimester, and we can follow the ISWOC guidelines for the structures, but we can go one step beyond that as well. So, starting with the head, the ISWOC guidelines expect us to make sure that the head is present, the cranial bones are seen, the midline fox is seen, and the choroid plexus fill up the ventricles. But it is also a good idea to measure the biparietal diameter. And this, of course, is because a small BPD can be a clue towards diagnosis of spina bifida. So again, make sure that the choroid plexus fill up the ventricle. This is again very important because now you can pick up ventricular megaly in the first trimester, though the criteria are not very well defined. There are a lot of articles which talk about various ratios of the choroid plexus in relation to the ventricles, etc. And here's one example of a ventricular megaly, and this is a normal, of course, choroid plexus. Then, of course, comes the most important thing, which is the intracranial translucency. So, in the same NT section which we already have taken, we can see that there are three sonolucent areas here. The first, of course, is the brainstem. The second is the IT, which is actually the fourth ventricle, and this one is, of course, the cisterna magna. And then these three black spaces have white lines. Here, of course, we have the outline, the brainstem, the roof of the fourth ventricle, the choroid plexus, and the occipital bone. So, typically, if you look at these three, that is the brainstem, the IT, and the cisterna magna, you typically have a ratio of 3:2:1. That means as you go from top to down, you have a slight decrease in size, and this can be very important in picking up either an IT obliteration or an IT increase in the size of the IT. So this is very important to look at when you do an NT scan. So typically, for example, here is an example where the intracranial translucency is obliterated. The brainstem looks very prominent, so that's a sign of neural tube defect. And here again, we can also take what is known as a brainstem to brainstem occipital distance, and typically this increases in open neural tube defect. So that's a brainstem size, and that's a brainstem to the occipital distance, because as we know that because of AMNOL-KL2, there's herniation of posterior structures, and the brainstem, this distance will increase. We can also look at the maxillo-occipital line, that is from the palate, you draw a line to the occiput, and under the normal circumstances, the junction between the thalamus and the midbrain lies above this line. But whenever there is a herniation of the posterior structures, this junction actually goes down this line, and that's another sign of open neural tube defect. Now, it's very important not only to look at BPD, but take a complete axial sweep. So we go from the top, look at a fox, go to the choroid plexus, and go further posterior, and also look at the posterior fossa. And just like what you see in a sagittal plane, the similar structures are seen in the posterior fossa. So again, here we have your brainstem, we have your IT or the fourth ventricle, and the cisterna magna. And this view can again be very, very important in picking up posterior fossa abnormalities at an early stage. So when you're taking a BPD, one step down, you can see the cerebral peduncles and the aqueduct of Sylvius. We can measure the distance between the aqueduct of Sylvius and the occipital bone. And typically, again, in spina bifida, what you see is parallel cerebrals, and the aqueduct of Sylvius is pushed towards the, moves towards the occiput, or sometimes it can get obliterated. So these are all indirect spines or signs of spina bifida or open neural tube defect. And Dr. Praveen has basically had put up all this together, and has described almost 13 signs of spina bifida in the first trimester, which one can easily look at. So that's the summary. Basically, we have an IT obliterated, increased distance, parallel cerebrals, aqueduct shifted down or not seen almost. And of course, then you need to look at for direct signs of spina bifida or open neural tube defect. We can have rarely an increase in the size of IT. So as we said, that as you go from year to year, we have a ratio of 3:2:1. Year we see that the IT is increased, and if you look very closely in the posterior fossa, you can almost appreciate that there's like a cystic structure, and this was a dandy walker picked up in the first trimester. So an increased IT, look out for posterior fossa abnormalities. Then we look at the face and the neck. Neck, of course, we just glance besides the NT, look at the neck whether it's normal. And in the face, we look at the profile, of course, of the face, the nasal bone, which we have talked about. We can look at the lips, of course, and of course, we can also look at the mandible. So the ISWA guidelines also talk about looking at eyes and lens. So what we can do is, again, in the same axial plane, which we took earlier for the head, we can go down, we can look at the orbits, and we can go further down and look at the alveolar ridge of the maxilla. So we can appreciate, that's in fact a 13 weeks plus a fetus, when you can see both the eyeballs as well as the lens in the first trimester in the NT scan. So we can also look at the lips and try and look at a nose lip view. This can be difficult, and picking up cleft lips is very, very difficult in the NT scan. The other marker which we look out for, typically, which is very useful in picking up cleft palates, is the retronasal triangle. So we take a coronal sweep again, go to the sort of nose lip, and then sweep down, and we can see the retronasal triangle with the palate forming the bane, the nasal bones at the top, and the margins of the maxilla. So we have three planes which can help us in picking up cleft palate. One is, of course, your the basic NT scan view, which is a sagittal view. Here we look out for two signs. One is make sure that the interrupted maxillary line sign, make sure that this line is not interrupted, and the second is a superimposed line. So what is superimposed line? Dr. Lakshmi has described this from India herself, from India. And if you look at this very carefully, the palate, you see that there are two sort of lines, one on the top and the one which is the basic palate. And this area here is actually formed by the vomo, and the vomo bone. And this she has labeled as a superimposed line. That means this vomo is superimposed on the palate. So what happens is, if there's a cleft in the palate, basically what you see is a single line, or absent superimposed line sign, as she called it. And what you see is basically only the vomo. And see, we'll see an example of that. In an axial plane, we can also look at the continuity of the alveolar ridge, because this is the same plane which we try in the second trimester. Of course, you don't see the uvula at this stage, and then make sure that the retronasal triangle is also intact. So this plane, three planes help us in picking up cleft palate. So the maxillary gap sign, of course, was described by Ravi Choi some years back and is reliable, but it has been challenged by some people. And what Dr. Lakshmi is described as a superimposed line, which is basically the vomo superimposed on the palatine line. But typically when you have, for example, a cleft in the palate, what you see is only the vomo bone. And this is, she has labeled as absence of the superimposed line sign. So she has two or three articles, both in the ISWA journal as well as in the AIUM journal, which I would urge you to read. And in fact, she has talked in our forum also earlier and written several articles, which you can actually go on the net and see to pick up cleft lip palate in the first trimester. So this is just one example where you can see that there is a gap in the maxillary line, and there is not only a cleft palate, there is also a cleft lip. And of course, this fetus also had a diaphragmatic hernia. And we have done most of the scan either with a transvaginal probe or with a high frequency probe. So we'll come to this point a little later. Typically, when you look at a retronasal triangle, there is a gap here, which is known as a mandibular gap. If the mandibular gap is absent, that could be a clue towards diagnosis of macrognathia. So we have one more thing which we can pick up with the help of the retronasal triangle. Then, of course, look at the spine itself, both in all three planes, that is the sagittal plane, the coronal plane, and of course the transverse sweep. Make sure that the overlying skin is intact. So besides looking at indirect signs, it is also very important to look at the spine itself. When you look at the chest, make sure that we have symmetrical lung fields. There's no effusion or any mass. you can pick up diaphragmatic hernias in the first trimester also when you see something odd happening in the chest. Then coming to the heart, of course, very important. What you should do, which all of us can do, of course, is take a sweep, which we are very familiar with in the first trimester. So when you take a sweep, very often it is very difficult to decide the site of the fetus or the lie of the fetus in the first trimester because the fetus is moving. But if you take a sweep and you can see that the stomach and the heart are on the same side, the axis of the heart is on the left side, and the heart grossly has a good size, then you have done a good job. So that's the stomach and the heart on the same side, that's the aorta on the same side, and at least you know that the situs of the fetus is normal. So one thing we should do is take a sweep. And then of course nowadays with high frequency probes and even with basic probes, you can see the four chambers and you can see the interventricular septum well if you hit it perpendicularly. And then of course it's a good habit to switch on color and again look at the four chambers flow. So we can just sort of make sure that your settings are correct and we can see the flow across the tricuspid and endometrial valve. And then of course we can go up just like in the second trimester and take a 3V trachea view again with the help of color Doppler and or power Doppler or whatever. And this is very often referred to as a tick sign in the first trimester. So we are picking up more and more of cardiac anomalies. Typically the ones which we pick up are things like atrioventricular septal defects, things like hypoplastic left heart, and of course we can also pick up outflow anomalies. Here for example, we had an extremely small aorta, we had a small left ventricle with a large cystic hygroma, and this was a fetus with Turner's. So here we have a fetus who had an omphalocele as well, and you can see that there is the right ventricle and you can see a large aorta coming from there and a small pulmonary artery. So that was a DORV. So a very important thing is the role of transvaginal scans. So whenever you suspect something, you should do a transvaginal scan. I'll go one step further and I would say that whenever you finish your NT scan, always put in a transvaginal probe and try and pick up as many. You might pick up something more what you may not have seen on transabdominal scan. And sometimes the fetal position is good, you can do almost like a complete target scan. Look at the abdomen, make sure that the stomach is present in the left upper quadrant. Make sure that the bladder is seen and you see two umbilical arteries. So all these things can be seen, kidneys can be seen. In fact, this is a 12 weeks, 4 days fetus. We are seeing both the kidneys with high resolution probes, a little bit of renal pelvis there, and we are seeing also the renal arteries at 12 weeks and 4 days of gestation. We can pick up gross renal anomalies and bladder abnormalities. Of course, megacystis can be picked up at this stage as well. Abdominal wall, very important. Look at the contour of the fetus. Make sure that the abdominal wall is intact. Again, look at the cord insertion, which is very, very important to pick up omphalocele, and make sure that again there are two umbilical arteries. So that's a cord incision in the abdominal wall. And of course, the most common thing we see in the first trimester are omphalocele. This is the same fetus who had also a DORV. Look at extremities. In fact, it is very easy to look at extremities in the first trimester because you get an overall glimpse of the picture. In the second trimester, very often one of the limb is sort of hiding behind the baby. So make sure that you see four limbs and each of the limb has three segments. In fact, you are able to see the hands and the hands also very well in most of the feti, and you can also see the extremities. Again, you can make sure that the three segments are there and that this angle between the tibia fibula and the foot is good. So this can be done, and we can pick up anomalies typically, for example, feti with reduced movements or skeletal dysplasia at this stage. So that's an example of a skeletal dysplasia picked up at an early stage. The other important role of NT scan is, of course, looking at the uterine artery to pick up or predict early onset preeclampsia and hypertension. So again, the FMF guidelines give us an idea about how to go about looking at the uterine artery. One can do transabdominally or one can do transvaginally. So typically what we do is look at the cervix at the internal os. and then move gradually to the right or the left. This can be done, as I said, transabdominally or transvaginally, but most of the times we do it transabdominally. Then, of course, identify the uterine arteries as they cross the iliac and try and get one full segment of the uterine arteries where it is straight, and then get a waveform of the uterine arteries. So we look at both the right and the left uterine artery, and what we are looking out for is the mean PI. So we no longer look at the pre-diastolic notch, etc. We are looking at mean PI, and most of the times the machine is going to calculate the mean PI for us directly. So we do have charts for, but for all practical purposes, a mean PI above 2.3 or 2.4 is considered as high in the first trimester. And there can be a little difference when you do a transvaginal approach. So here's an example of a transabdominal scan where the mean PI is high, 3.0 at 11 weeks and 2 days, and she later on had a preeclampsia. So we can also predict preeclampsia maybe in a better way by combining uterine artery Doppler, the mean arterial pressure of the mother, and the serum biochemistry. So in this, we can add PLGF. Again, people say that PLGF probably doesn't have much of value. We can predict the same thing by using only free beta and PAPE and the uterine artery Doppler. But if you add PLGF, maybe there could be a little improvement in your pickup rate of preeclampsia. So here, for example, we have done a biochemical marker and an NT scan with the mean arterial pressure and the uterine artery PI. And we see that the risk of preeclampsia in this case is high, and sure, the risk of trisomy 21 was also very, very high. So we can combine these things together. So as it is, we do double markers. So we can ask the lab to, we have to give the, so basically mean arterial pressure again has to be calculated. So we give the pressure reading as per the FMF guidelines to the lab along with the requisition form, and then we can get the calculated risk. So in summary, one section, we can see so many things, and I think if you look at value for money or for whatever, the value of this NT scan, the utility is tremendous, and all we need to do is keep our eyes open, and we can help the mother in several ways. Thank you so much for your kind attention.